Baie welkom hier by die Universiteit van Stellenbosch raakvlak tussen die wetenskap en die publiek. Ek dink is 'n baie belangrike forum waar ons mekaar se velde verken. Wetenskaplikes soos hier links van my is vreemde diere wat in vreemde laboratoria en donker kamers werk. Die publiek loop in die lig en hulle verstaan mekaar nie altyd nie. Die voertaal van ons onderhoude is in Engels, alhoewel beide van my gaste Afrikaans is, maar u is baie, baie welkom om enige vraag in Afrikaans te vra en ons probeer so ver as moontlik dan u vraag ook in Afrikaans beantwoord. My eerste gas is professor Hans Strydom. Hy is by die fakulteit Mediese Wetenskappe aan die Universiteit van Stellenbosch. God, ek moet Engels praat. At the Medical Faculty of the University of Stellenbosch. He is in the Medical Physiology Division, Senior Lecturer in Human and Medical Physiology and Undergrad Medical and Allied Health Science students he handles. Most of my guests have CVs that I don't understand in the least. I look at his publications and I couldn't even pronounce half of it. But suffice it to say that he's a physiologist. My second guest is Professor Corinne Smith, who is also at our university, and she attained her PhD in physiological sciences at the University of Stellenbosch. And the focus of what we're going to do tonight and discuss, I am going to throw a hand grenade over my left shoulder very soon. The minute we start, somebody fires up some guitar behind us, but be that as it may. We last night had a critical look at what happens if we inhale, drink, smell, touch all the chemicals we have in our homes. Tonight we're coming much closer to home and looking at what happens if we partake in stimulants and supplements, and what happens to our bodies when that happens. I'm going to give both of our guests 12 to 15 minutes to paint themselves out of their academic corner and tell us what they do. But for instance, what happens when I light a cigarette and I put a thermocouple between my toes? The temperature of my toe will drop immediately by a degree or a degree and a half due to constriction, cardiovascular constriction. What on earth happens if you drink one of those little blue cans with the wings on it? Goodness knows alone. I mean, I have no idea what happens to my body. And this is why it's so exciting to have two specialists here to tell us what happens. So Hans, could we ask you to give us an idea of what you do?
Thank you very much for the introduction. So I'm actually a qualified medical doctor, and I worked as a doctor for 5 or 6 years before I got interested in the academics. And I started at the medical physiology department at Tygerberg campus. Completed my PhD in cardiovascular physiology. So cardiovascular refers to the heart and blood vessels of the body, and also do some teaching. And currently we're busy with quite a big study looking at the effects of HIV infection and the treatment of HIV on the vascular system in humans. So that is quite a big population study that we're currently busy with. So my specific interest is actually the vascular system, the blood vessels of the body. And the reason why I have decided that as my focus point is because the majority of cardiovascular diseases, and that includes stroke, heart disease, kidney disease, start in the blood vessels. A lot of people don't realize that heart attack, for example, is in the majority of cases not a problem with the heart itself, but with the blood vessels that supply the heart with blood and oxygen. The nice thing about knowing more about the blood vessels in the body is if one can find ways to detect disease early in the blood vessels, One can still reverse the process. And and that is basically what we're trying to find, are markers or biomarkers of blood vessel disease that one can use to predict potential future disease or heart disease and save lives. So that's sort of the medical and clinical side of our interest. Your question about the cigarette is a very valid question and an interesting question. And in fact, one of my PhD students last year and the year before did quite a comprehensive study on the effects of nicotine, which, as we all know, is one of the main ingredients in cigarette smoke, and the effects on the blood vessels. Now, of course, we use rats in our laboratory. So if anybody's squeamish, apologies for that, but we use rats. And the nice thing about rats is that they are very predictive of human physiology, funnily enough. And she used nicotine, so we injected the rats with nicotine, and then we also treated them with rooibos tea, to see if the ingestion of rooibos tea could perhaps improve the effects of the nicotine on the blood vessels. Now, what nicotine does, it causes, as you mentioned earlier, constriction. In other words, the blood vessels, the diameter of the blood vessels becomes smaller, so they contract, which means that there is reduced blood flow to the vital organs, such as the brain or the heart or the kidney. And she found that those rats that got the nicotine, received the nicotine, and drank rooibos tea, the effects that she found of the nicotine on the blood vessels was completely alleviated. So that's I think we can tick the rooibos tea box for our audience. We're still trying to figure out exactly, because rooibos tea has got a lot of active ingredients, as we all know, or might be aware of. So that still needs to be sorted out. The other interesting molecule that she looked at, which is actually also available over the counter, and some of you might have used it before when you travel overseas, crossing time zones, is a molecule called melatonin. Now, melatonin is actually a hormone that is released by the brain, and it dictates our day-night cycle. Some people also refer to it as the hormone of darkness. So the moment the sun starts setting and it becomes dark, our brain starts releasing more of this hormone, and it makes us sleepy. So it is also a natural sleeping tablet. But we didn't use it for that purpose. We also know that melatonin is most likely to be the most potent antioxidant in the body. And so what Michelle did, the PhD student, was those exact rats that were treated with a nicotine, we also treated them with melatonin in the drinking water. And we found the melatonin to have exactly the same effects than the rooibos tea. So those are just a few examples of stuff that we use every day or that are available over the counter that can actually have quite impressive effects on our blood vessels.
Could I just come in here? Why on earth did you select rooibos and not St. John's wort or rosemary or anything else? Were there indicators that rooibos... The other thing I wanted to say, I mean, I just pity the poor rats. You could use students on Stellenbosch, and you don't have to inject them at all, but they don't drink rooibos.
The problem is you have to take out the aortas at some stage, and we can't do that to the students. Yes, so the indicator was that we know that rooibos has very beneficial effects on the cardiovascular system. Not the specific interest that she was looking or field that she was looking at has not been shown before. But so there were enough predictors, and of course it's a beverage that is used very commonly in South Africa. The melatonin we knew from before that it is a potent antioxidant as well.
Okay, thank you. Now, can we ask you to start, Corinne, telling us about what you do?
Thanks, Dave. So I'm a stress immunologist. I study the links between, basically, why does stress make us sick? And quite interesting, stress, the modern lifestyle, which is increased stress levels combined with sedentary lifestyle and poor diet, actually causes symptoms very much like aging, but actually in an accelerated fashion. So our modern lifestyle is causing us to age faster. So my group in particular at the moment are interested in the interaction between oxidative stress and inflammation, because those systems have been shown to be implicated in the development of most of our chronic diseases. And because we quite closely link with industry, we've come across a number of quite interesting natural medicines or alternative therapies that we have tested over the years. You look like you want to say something.
No. I'm deeply interested because I've had stand-up fights with Kraya doctors and the likes, which don't conduct clinical tests, you know, and say, if you take three leaves of this and the egg of a tunk-tunky and you make a little cocktail, your cataract will disappear, which is complete nonsense, of course. But I'm interested to hear that both of you seem to be using commonly available, widely used substances. And so I just would like to know about the clinical proof.
Yes. So in terms of natural medicine, the sequence of events before we get a product on the shelf is somewhat different from traditional pharmaceuticals, where with traditional medicines, you would start in a lab and isolate a molecule or synthesize a molecule, and then after that, investigate what its effect is on cells, and then animals, and then humans. With traditional medicine, we kind of come from the other way, where we know that anecdotally it's supposed to have particular effects. And then we go backward and we test to see whether there's any merit in the claims made for it. Now, I actually want to say from the onset, I'm not against all natural medicines. Although I have published some negative effects in the past, I think the problem comes in where when it's usually someone trying to make money off indigenous knowledge, takes a product which is, or a medicine which is intended for use in a very specific population for a very specific reason, and try to apply it out of context to the broad population. And then all kinds of odd side effects pop up, which actually gives quite useful natural medicines a bad name. So our group's focus it's almost like a pet project, is to investigate these different natural medicines to pinpoint exactly who will benefit from it and who not.
We have an enormously rich, I nearly said repository of natural medicines in this country, and a lot of it's very quickly dying out. Fieldcraft naturalists don't exist anymore. And, you know, if we hadn't had the diaries of Bleek for the sun, for instance, we wouldn't have known half as much we know about them today. So I think it's extremely important to investigate the healing properties while there are still links to the felt and to the tradition and collecting and preparation. Because, as you know, the slightest variance in collecting seasonally might affect the strength or the effectivity thereof. But from both of you, let's go to some rather risky stuff. I mean, rooibos and Sutherlandia. I mean, it this is mild stuff. What happens if we start using other supplements? I mean, you go downtown and suddenly there's a young man that blocks out the sun, he's so pumped up, and he stands behind huge canisters of, say, if you drink this stuff, you're going to look like me. Do you know anything about these? additives and stimulants that they use?
Well, yes, we do. There's nothing.
Tell us about
it. Well, Karine, I don't know. Can I just say? Yeah. I mean, I suppose you're thinking of something like growth hormone, which is shockingly readily available out there. I'm sure that many of you might suspect that those of us that go to gym, you won't believe how commonly these things are distributed.
Yeah.
In the gym. Now growth hormone, for one, which has a very profound effect on the physique, has absolutely terrible effects on the heart muscle. Because just as your skeletal muscle responds to the effects of growth hormone, so does your heart muscle. And you often end up with a heart, you know, half the size of your chest. And a lot of these guys die of heart failure.
Yeah.
The same goes for testosterone. I don't know if you wanted to add something on.
No, well, I had a student when I was still teaching. He was an absolute fish moth. And and he graduated, and the next year he turned into, it looked like the Bell of Kiev. I mean, he sort of quadrupled in size. I couldn't recognize that. He had a squeaky voice, but otherwise, I mean, he was I couldn't recognize the poor thing. And he must have been taking something. I suspect it's much more common because we have, this is a town of students where people experiment, and perhaps recklessly so, with substances of all kinds. There was in the journal Science last week an article predicting that clever children are more inclined to try substance abuse than the dull few, you know? So it's the bright sparks that are reckless. Do we have... I'll give the audience some question time now. Is there any cause for concern that there's certain substances are predicted to become problems soon? Are we eating too much of certain things? Are we overdosing on vitamins? Are we taking too much melatonin? Are we hooked on these things?
I think for sure people are prone to overdosing actually on what you might call mellow substances, the things we think are healthy because they're natural. And research have shown time and again that even your vitamins A and C and E, are quite toxic when you take them in too high quantities. So, I think it's important to remember, even when you're taking a natural product, you have to do so only when you require it, and then in moderate quantities. So just because it's natural, more isn't necessarily better.
No.
Because our body's still in a very tightly controlled balance. And as soon as you throw it out of balance by supplementation, no matter how healthy the supplement in itself is, you'll end up with problems.
Okay, now let's see if the audience has any burning questions. Anybody there? We have a hand at the back.
Would using rats are they susceptible to the placebo effect?
That's a good question. I mean, rats are clever.
You will be surprised how the placebo effect is not necessarily a human trait. So that is why we always have to build into our experiments a what we either call a sham group, or a vehicle group. So if you give a substance to the animals that is dissolved in water or whatever, you have to give that very same volume without the ingredient that you're testing. And you often find, to the scientist's disappointment, that if you do your statistics, you sometimes find that there's no differences between the placebo group and the treatment group. So yes, they are susceptible under certain conditions. So it is very important to always have a group like that in your experimental design.
Just from a biologist's point of view, animals tend and the higher the hierarchy, if you go to primates, watch each other completely the whole time. You know, they mimic. And even in things like birds of prey, you would find that peregrine falcons in adjoining nests would specialize in totally different prey species because they've learned, it's learned behavior. It's quite idiosyncratic. So that was a good question. Yeah. Anybody else? Come on, you must have doubts about what you're eating. Oh, well, I'm afraid this is a trap. It's a medical doctor.
My name is Hannes Lutz. I want to ask you two questions. The one is, are there any substances except red wine that we should take? Because we don't pull carrots out of the ground anymore and just wipe them on the leaves and get all those minerals in, because we drink filtered water and we drink all these pasteurized stuff. So are there any supplements that we should take? And secondly, what will be the application of marijuana in the treatment in the future? Are the synthetic products similar to the good and strong products from Swaziland? Thank you.
I can maybe answer that one. One of the substances you should take is spring water, lots of it. Other than that, I think most natural things are modified these days. But I would like to comment on marijuana or cannabis. We've started doing some work on that. And I think in the literature, there's a lot of evidence that we have anti-inflammatory action, and some compounds also show anti-cancer effects. The interesting thing that we see both with cannabis and with other plant extracts like scalitium, which some of you may have heard of, is that if you take the alkaloid that you think is affecting a particular effect in isolation, it seems to have a different or lesser effect than when it is used in synergy with all the other components of a plant. So we at the moment actually doing some very exciting research. My students are sitting on the blue couch over there, so please ask them questions afterwards. But where we, with the help of a very a pleasant industry contact, we are manipulating some of these plants and making extracts that are higher in particular alkaloids or active agents, but still contain all the other ingredients in the plant. And we're having amazing effects with that. So I think definitely the plant homeostasis and interaction between components are as important. Not all actives can be isolated as a pharmaceutical. Yeah.
What are the main treatments? Nausea, I believe, for cannabis?
Pain
treatment. It has a wide application as far as I can figure out.
Yeah.
As a sleeping draught, we know that. Mm. I at least do. Mm-hmm. I've tried it, and it's not my poison.
Appetite stimulant.
falling asleep is not fun. Be that as it may. Right, we have a question at the back there.
I would just like to ask about cannabis and the synergistic effects with other analgesics available on the pharmaceutical market, because it's... some people say, I know some of the patients say that it works very well for them if they have an incurable disease like cancer and so on. What is your comments on that, please? Can you hear?
There's no beater, yeah.
Ik het gehoor, dankie.
Yeah, okay.
Cannabis, as you know, in South Africa, although cannabis is widely available, it's not so to researchers. We have to apply for permits before we can use it. So research into cannabis and the interactions with other prominently or commonly used drugs and medicines are actually only in its infant shoes at the moment. We you have to remember cannabis is prohibited for particular reasons because there are also known side effects. So at the moment, we are focusing on particular components in cannabis and then interaction of those components which we know have more beneficial than detrimental effects. And we are studying interactions, but those results, I think, is still too preliminary to communicate.
Dave, can I be a bit spontaneous here?
Please.
Because I want to come back to my good colleague's question earlier, and he mentioned it in the passing, so it wasn't really part of his question, but he was talking about the red wine. He said, accept red wine as what we all should take. And I just want to say that red wine is absolutely amazing for the cardiovascular system from a physiological point of view. So, and that is not just because of anecdotal evidence. A lot of science and research has actually been done on red wine in terms of the blood vessels and the heart. Mm. And we know exactly why it is good for the heart and the blood vessels. But of course, on the downside, it has to be taken in moderation. But if you stick to a certain quantity of red wine per day, we know that it is good for your cardiovascular health.
Talking of red wine brings me to think about the much touted Mediterranean diet. Mm. And currently in the literature, there's a lot to be said again. It's coming back all the time to the salutary effects of the Mediterranean diet. Could both of you comment on that from your perspectives? Olive oil, wine, lots of fresh vegetables, the kind of thing.
Yeah, I think the one thing that most of the ingredients of that diet have in common is that it's quite high in polyphenol content. And we've been studying that for a while now in various substances. And we know that polyphenols have antioxidant capacity, it's anti-inflammatory, because the inflammatory system and the stress endocrine system links in so closely, it's also beneficial to reduce even the effects of chronic stress. So I have a PhD student studying that at the moment, and it's fascinating actually that grapeseed extract is currently marketed as an anti-aging compound. And it quite possibly is one, because we see that it reverses symptoms of arthritis. We see that it limits the detrimental effects seen with stress and the normal aging related detriments.
One wonders if this diet had some sort of Darwinian selective pressure in developing, you know, that it selected itself as a salutary way to live. I mean, God, you just need to look at Spain. Mm. You know, it's all mañana and the paseo after dark,
yeah,
and a bit of sleeping.
The
lifestyle is just so. Absolutely adore it.
Yeah.
I tried it while an academic, and you can't sleep in your office over lunchtime. It doesn't work. But hang on, there was another question. Any more questions from the audience? There we have one.
Op my ouderdom gryp 'n mens maar na grashalmpies teen Alzheimer's en vergeetachtigheid. En een van die grashalmpies wat ek verneem het is omega 3. So ek sou graag u siening daaroor wil verneem.
Karin. Karin, help. Nee, duidelik goed vir die hart en die bloedvate weer eens. Antioxidant, jy kan ons help, want jylle doet
ja.
Ons op die stadium baie navorsing gedoen.
Ja, not myself, but colleagues in the department. They have shown quite beneficial effects, I must say mostly in terms of cardiac metabolism.
Yes.
I'm not too sure about Alzheimer's in particular. But on that front, I can actually tell you that also Alzheimer's has a huge component of inflammation in its etiology. So if you can limit inflammation and oxidative stress, the progression of the disease will also be stunted.
A question to both of you. If you were to have a future glance, where would you like to take your research? Are there sort of burning questions in terms of your focus that you'd like to look at, Hans?
We're aiming for the 2020 Nobel Prize.
Ooh, okay.
Yeah, well, why wait so long? Why wait so long?
No, Dave, as I mentioned in my short intro, from my point of view, as a clinician and somebody that still has in my heart, my figurative heart, to save lives is to really find markers that one can use to predict future cardiovascular disease before the disease starts. Mm. So that one can actually go to young people, because what we're finding more and more is that heart disease is starting to shift generations. It's becoming a younger and younger disease. And so we're losing, you know, economically active people. So that would be my ultimate aim, is if one can first of all detect changes early, predict, and then start interventional therapy, be it lifestyle or be it pharmacological. Mm. That would be my ultimate. Yeah.
Just to comment on that, I think that the problem with the youth is, of course, they think they're completely invincible. Mm. I this weekend shouted at one who spent the whole day in the sun. They don't know that by 50 they look like a Gucci handbag. You know, they've turned into something quite appalling, but they think they're completely invincible. Corinne, what are you looking at?
I think in South Africa, I think given our context as a developing country, I don't think we can afford ourselves the luxury to stick to basic science and doing science for the academic, pure academic interest. I think we have
responsibility.
We have the responsibility to also do research that's applicable to the man in the street, to inform him on, you know, how to improve health. The facts are that globally the population is aging. We're living longer. That doesn't mean we're living healthier for longer. It just means that we struggle longer at the end. Mm-hmm. The other fact is that we have, about 5 years ago, natural healers outnumbered traditional Western doctors 10 to 1. So we have this wealth of indigenous knowledge that's actually not scientifically tested, so that we can make the most of that. So I think that would be my purpose, is to use what we have and to provide scientific proof so that we can apply what we have for the people in our country.
Yeah. One of the problems we discussed last night is once you have proof, which is scientifically tight, how do you roll this out to a stupid public? I'm not looking at them, but we don't speak the same language. So are you also thinking of how can you transfer this knowledge in an accessible form to the public? Because that's very true. I mean, if I look at your CV, I mean, it's complete gobbledygook to me, but it needs to be translated into digestible chunks for the public. And that's, I think, as important, perhaps.
Yes. I think, where's Vida? I think Stellenbosch University is quite privileged that we have a very good relationship with the media and with Vida as our contact with the media. We do communicate our research quite widely through radio and lay publications as well as the scientific ones. The other quick way of getting research out there is to let your industry partner have some results, because they just give it to the advertisers and it's everywhere. Yeah. So I think there are ways, and I think we are getting better and better at communicating our information. Yeah. And then, of course, evenings like these doesn't do any damage either.
No, not at all. The problem, of course, in my view, is that you have to deal with abject poverty, and penetrating the realm of the abjectly poor is incredibly difficult. How dare you waste their time with information when they're just scrabbling to make a living every day? So there's another component to this.
Yeah. Dave, just on that point, the community outreach point, which scientists are really not good at. Last year, my research group and I collaborated with an NGO where the whole idea of the project was to translate science to the community of Delft. I suppose most of the audience know about Delft, which is a really, really poor township outside Cape Town. And we spent the whole year, every month or 6 weeks, my research group and I went into Delft and we had community events with the public to translate not only science but also disease and risk factors into language that the community members could understand, and the impact that made was absolutely amazing. So I really think that scientists, just because you mentioned that about the poverty that and the socioeconomic discrepancy that we're dealing with in South Africa, that's where the diseases are.
Exactly.
And that's where no treatment is. So I do think that the community outreach and forcing scientists to start thinking, not in journal article terms, but also how people on the ground think and the language that they speak is really, really important.
Yes, I think, sorry, if I can just add to that, our department in particular is quite well networked to primary care clinics. And we give the clinicians the information and they transfer it to their patients. I'm quite confident that we are at least starting to reach the right levels of people.
Okay, but I think this is all quite tame. Let's cause some trouble. Why are people so gullible, generally speaking, to suddenly take on a new diet? And we think, you know, we all know about the great revolution of, shall I say it, Banting? You know, the world went completely mad. And you'd have a Pat Stalik in your, you know, Klaverfontein selling Banting grapes or something. The whole world went completely mad and the entire world was completely polarized. Why are we so gullible that we always want to climb on the bandwagon with something new, although we know that if you eat a normal, healthy diet, you'll be fine? Why are we so gullible?
I don't think we're gullible. I think we're too lazy to do it the right way.
That's it.
I think there's a little bit of a fair measure of vanity involved, Dave.
Mm.
Especially with the diets.
Yeah.
And I think it's human nature to be vain. And I just think that, you know, when you read in the popular press, there's this diet that, you know, you're gonna lose weight, but you can still eat this, and you're gonna lose weight. And so I think I might be a bit cynical, but I do think that a lot of these diets, and I'm not specifically referring to the Banting,
of course,
because there's a lot of science that went into that, but I think does exploit
vanity.
Certain human traits, and vanity is one of them.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at Philip II, I mean, he was a terrible king, but Philip never in his life, he hated vegetables. He only ate meat, and he reached a good young age of 78 when he died, rather painfully. But so you think it's simply appealing to vanity? Because
not simply, I think it plays a big role.
Because there's a whole horizon of vanity products, as we know. You know, put this on your face and you look like a Kardashian or something. Okay, let's test the audience. Come on, I've hopefully loosened them up a little bit. There we go.
Vir die dokter 'n makvraag. As mens nie kan suiwelprodukte gebruik nie en jy moet kyk na kalsium, is dit nodig om te kyk na kalsiumaanvullings en wat gaan in die are saampak nie. Vir die dame, jy het gesê jy het 'n pet project, so asseblief expose hulle. Ons wil weet wie hulle is wat ons geld mors.
Ek dink calcium kan ons maar in Afrikaans.
Ja, natuurlik.
Calcium aanvulling dink ek nie sal 'n mens net eenvoudig universeel voorskryf vir enige pasiënt onder alle omstandighede as hulle nie kan melk drink. Ek dink dit hang tog af of daar sekere risiko is in die pasiënt in terme van beenverlies, want dit is eintlik maar waaroor dit op die ou end gaan. So ek sal baie versigtig wees om, soos wat Karine ook vroeër gesê het, jy weet, selfs met kalsium aanvulling. Jy weet, kan 'n mens sekere perke oorskry en dit kan tot toksisiteit lei. So ek dink daar moet 'n mens baie versigtig wees. Daar's baie ander natuurlike bronne van kalsium in elk geval wat 'n mens kan drink en eet.
Ja, miskien kan ek net byvoeg, een van die algemeenste neeweffekte van te veel kalsium is nierstene. So dit wys vir jou iets wat eintlik lyk, dis iets wat jou liggaam nodig het, maar as jy dit oordoen, dan kry jy iets wat baie onaangenaam kan wees. Ja.
Karine, het jy, ons wag vir nog 'n vraag, iets sê oor Sutherlandia, die ou bekende kankerbos. Ek sien jy het navorsing gedoen daaroor.
Ja, ons is aanvanklik genader deur iemand uit die industrie wat dit wou bemark. So ons het aanvanklik gekyk na die anti-stress effekte van Sutherlandia en ons het eintlik verskriklike oulike resultate gekry. Ons het meestal in diere gewerk. En miskien om aan te sluit by die vraag wat die meneer daar agter gevra het oor hoe relevant rotte is tot mense. Net interessantheidshalwe, as jy 'n stresstudie doen op rotte, hulle het ook 'n sosiale hiërargie soos mense. Jy kan hulle nie isoleer nie, want dan is hulle jammer vir hulle self, dan het hulle spontane stresreaksie. Hulle het ook onderdanige individue en baasspelerige individue. So jy moet baie mooi sorg dat jy die groeperings reg het in 'n hok, as jy nie wil moeilikheid hê nie. So ons het rotte gedoen, ons het 'n baie, ek weet nie of ek wil nou nie iemand ontstel hier vanaand nie, maar wat ons basies doen om stres in rotte te veroorsaak, is ons gee hulle basies engte vrees. Hulle hou nie van groot oop spasies nie en hulle hou nie van klein spasies nie. So ons sit vir hulle in klein spasies en dan het hulle spontane 'n kortisol respons. En so kan ons van hierdie middels toets en ons kyk ook na gewoontetjies wat vir ons wat mens kan kwantifiseer, wat vir jou kan sê hoe gestres of hoe angstig hierdie rotte is. So ons het in terme van Sutherlandia het ons begin en ons het gesien daar's definitief effek, dit voorkom die endokriene, die hormoonafskeiding wat stres tot gevolg het. En toe het ons verder gegaan en ons het gesien dat in baie mense wat kroniese siektes het soos in kanker, het hulle nogal moeite om hulle spiermassa te behou. Hulle raak mos swak. Daai uitgeteerdheid wat jy kry. En Sutherlandia verhoed daai afbraak van spier. So dis eintlik 'n baie veelsidige kreatief wat jy vir jou daar kan maak. Iets wat ons nou wel onlangs gekyk het en dit is wat ek na verwys het, is hoe spesifieke mense moet gaan en hoeveel jare se navorsing jy eintlik doen voor jy die hele antwoord het. Ons het gesien, ons het gekyk na neuroinflammasie. Rukkie terug was dit groot nuus dat hulle gesê het in na HIV-infeksie is daar baie kort nadat jy aan die virus blootgestel word reeds die eerste tekens van neuroinflammasie wat op die ou end natuurlik neurodegenerasie tot gevolg het. En ons het gekyk of Sutherlandia, ons het toevallig Sutherlandia en 'n wynpolifenool getoets in 'n model van die bloedbrein skans en ons het gekyk na HIV neuroinflammasie. En Sutherlandia het neuroinflammasie gekeer solank daar nie HIV betrokke was nie. En sodra dit 'n HIV toestand was, 'n HIV positiewe toestand, dan het dit actually vererger. So dit beteken as jy Sutherlandia wil gebruik, kan jy dit net gebruik en jy kan dit net voorskryf vir iemand wat nie HIV positief is nie. En dis iets belangriks om te weet, die natuurlike kennis wat oorgelewer was, het nooit dit in ag geneem nie. Want dit is nie iets wat bestaan het so lank terug nie.
Einstein, one tends to think of, you know, Sutherland has had the name Kankerbos for 250 years. Yes. So somewhere there's a huge pool of untapped wisdom that had and it brings one to the question, how on earth did they figure out that this was Kankerbos, you know, and it must have taken thousands of years of trial and error.
Yeah,
and 10 to 1 killed a number of people as well. Oh, we have a question. Sorry, I'm mumbling.
Can I just finish, Dave?
Oh, sorry.
Interestingly about the Sutherlandia, if you talk to the indigenous, the natural healers, they will also tell you where you pick your Sutherlandia is important. In some parts of the country, they will tell you the Sutherlandia is good against cancer, and in some other parts of the country, it's good for stress. So we've actually tested the content of, we've taken habitat seeds from different geographical areas and we had it planted in a homogeneous batch. And we found huge differences in the effects that these different plant products gave us.
That's extraordinary.
So it's more complex than just picking it and having your effect.
Indeed. There we are.
Ek het 'n vraag. Die graankossoorte wat ons elke dag eet, kom of van plante wat geneties gemanipuleer is met minder chemikalieë of van plante wat nie geneties gemanipuleer is nie met meer chemikaliese bespuitings. Het enige van die dokters al in enige van die twee kategorieë enige negatiewe effekte op ons liggame opgetel?
Ek kan nie uit eie ondervinding praat nie, want ons doen nou nie spesifiek daarop navorsing nie, maar die vraag is baie geldig. En ek dink dat wat die genetiese gemanipuleerde graankosse betref, of enige voedsel, want is ook vleis wat daardoor geraak word, dink ek is dit nog baie vroeg om wetenskaplike gevolgtrekkings te maak. Hierdie type van goed gaan mens oor jare en dekades moet navors voor een mens werkelijk kan sê. So ek dink op die oomblik, daar is 'n vreeslike hype daaroor, maar ek dink ons weet nog nie. Ons weet nog net eenvoudig nie, en ek dink mens moet versigtig wees om uitsprake te maak voor 'n mens nie, voor die kliniese studies nie terugkom.
Could we go to the organic and non-organic scene? Because, no, I'm serious, because there's talk about hype. A recent study in Norway had people selecting organic bananas and non-organic bananas, and everybody said, "Ooh, the organic tastes better." In the end, they cut standard bananas in half and labeled one organic and the other one, and everybody went for the organic. So people are enormously gullible. Any indicators of the relative value of organically produced produce? Which includes sheep and chickens and what have you.
Yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't eat an organic pig.
Apart from the price.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think maybe the food scientists and the agriculturists would be better suited to answer that. But from a physiology point of view, I think an important consideration is the effect that differences in these foodstuffs have on our gut. A lot of literature is coming out now on what is called the gut microbiota, so the normal bacteria that's present in your gut. It's quite interesting. I listened to a talk at a conference last year where they spoke to someone who analyzed the different bacteria present in different populations. And native Indians have a huge variety of normal flora, the normally occurring bacteria, and if they compare that to the modern American living in the same area but through generations have become more westernized, they've lost many different bacterial strains from their body. And we now know that your gut even talks back to your brain, so I'm sure what we eat can influence the bacterial population in your body, which affects all your other physiological systems.
Yeah. I think that's an interesting artifact, because Surprisingly, there's very little nutritional difference between a farmed egg and an organic egg, but the damn thing tastes different. The flavoroids are much more potent. You know, if a chicken eats beta carotene and you've got a nice yellow yolk, same goes for apples and so on. Nutritionally, it's quite this, you know, there's not much to choose from, but it comes to these tiny things like an unwashed apple that you don't need to wash with a natural coating of lovely bugs on it. There.
Can I ask a question?
You may.
Okay. If I wake up in the morning, I am not awake until I've had at least 2 cups of coffee. Amen, I hear. Is that okay?
Well, I mean, I think most of us probably suffer from that problem. So I wouldn't even regard it as a problem. I just think it's fantastic. I mean, I'm a coffeeholic. It's okay. So you can relax. It's fine. I mean, if you need your coffee boost in the morning, that's fine. It's obviously the caffeine that is well-known stimulant, and actually people often think too much of anything is bad, but coffee is and caffeine is actually quite healthy, and it has quite, at least in terms of the cardiovascular system, over the short term it causes the blood vessels to dilate very nicely, which is very good. It's good for your blood pressure. It is protective of the muscle cells in the heart, and it has the added effect of waking you up. So I am not an anti-coffee proponent at all. I can only recommend a coffee. Yeah. 2 or 3 cups even in the morning.
Yeah.
I think part of the benefit is also the ritual involved, in drinking coffee, just like tea. It actually has a soothing effect, which is good for everyone with a stressful lifestyle.
Yeah. If you go to Ethiopia, of course, and you go through a full coffee ritual, you need at least 40 minutes for it. So you know, we don't have that kind of lifestyle. I see a number of people have started drifting off. Do we have another question? Oh, Professor Stein.
Hello. Now, two comments. I believe in Finland that they have the highest consumption of coffee. It's about 15 cups per day, and they're perfectly happy. The question in terms of the negative effects on GM wheat products like maize, corn, etc. Recently, a very substantial report from the American Academy of Sciences appeared, and they showed no negative effect in terms of GM products, except for people who may be susceptible, allergic to it. So it's basically very safe. I think this concern about GM, it's been shown to be nonsense.
No. I suspect that the GM debate's not going to go away very quickly. They're constantly, I see yesterday in New Scientist, for instance, they said that that Roundup now has yet again been suggested that it's a carcinogenic, you know, which is, it's a bit Donald Trumpish, you know, it sounds a bit like fake news. Until you've proved it, you shouldn't be talking about it, you know, and causing ripples in the pond. We've come to the end of our meeting, and I really wish to thank our two guests for enlightening us with a great number of subjects. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you for sharing. Just lastly, we have a Facebook page, Science Cafe. If you have any burning questions about anything, do not be afraid. This is a forum where we must be fearless. And dit is 'n groot probleem met ons ou volkie, damn it, jy weet, hulle is so bang om te praat. Ons is so ordentlik. Moenie ordentlik wees nie. Vra moeilike vrae. Dit is waarom wetenskaplikes daar is, om hierdie moeilike goed uit te pak op 'n beskaafde manier. Dames en here en my gaste, baie dankie.